Better than Lucia, sun and time shall be no more. And the morning grace in time of bright and fair, when the same of us shall gather to the on the other shore, and the road is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the road is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. On the bright and glorious morning, when the dead in Christ shall rise, and the glory of his resurrection share, when his chosen ones shall gather to the on the other shore, and the road is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the road is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. Let us labor for the Master from the dawn to setting sun. Let us talk of all his wondrous love and care. Then when all the life is over and the work on earth is done, and the road is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the road is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. When the road is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
We shall go on with hymn number 213. Number 213, lift up. And number 213, lift up the trumpet.
Lift up the trumpet and now let it sing. Jesus is coming again. Jesus, the pilgrim. Joyful and sing, Jesus is coming again. Coming again, coming again. Jesus is coming again. Echoing the hymns, proclaiming his name. Jesus is coming again. Jesus is coming again. Nations are hungry, by this we do know. Jesus is coming again. Knowledge increases, let them run to and fro. Jesus is coming again. Coming again, coming again. Jesus is coming.
Sabbath, everyone, once again.
Happy day.
Happy day. We shall go on with hymn number 190.
hymn number 190 that says, Jesus loves me, this I know. 190, Jesus loves me, this I know.
Jesus loves me, yes I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little words to me did wrong, they are weak but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me. He who died, heaven's gate to open wide. Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Jesus, take his heart of mine. Let it be pure and holy night. On the cross you died for. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
I'm here to present to you a mission story. Our mission story comes to us from Russia. And our title today saying that make friends with God. But before we start presenting, shall we pray? Dear Father in heaven, we thank you for your gift of love. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you for the gift of life you give us, and we thank you for your protection. Dear Father in heaven, we are requesting you in this presentation, we are going to follow Jesus, help each and everyone here and understand the work of the value of your work. In Jesus' name, amen. Our title today is Making Friends with God. When Masha was 5 years old, she watched her old sister got baptized. When she heard the pastor and other church members congratulate her, old sister, she spent 1 year wondering how being baptized is so wonderful occasion. When she was 6 years, she decided that she was old enough to be baptized, and she told her mother that she wanted to be baptized. Her mother thought that she was still young and told her that you'll wait up when you get 10 years old so that you'll be baptized. The year passed near her birthday of 10 years old. She remembered that her decision is approaching. Then, when she remembered that the time is coming to be baptized, she went to the pastor and told him that I want to be baptized. The pastor was so happy with her decision and invited to join a baptism class with the 8 older children. The class was interesting, but the pastor was transferred to another church. The new pastor refused to baptize her. He told her that, "I'm sorry, but you are too young." Marsha felt disappointed. She didn't talk to the new pastor for a while. When she was 12, she decided to ask him again whether she could be baptized. The pastor agreed and invited her to join his baptismal class. Marsha attended for 4 months, but for more reason, the class didn't seem interesting anymore. All she could think about was how long she had wanted to be baptized, and the pastor had refused to baptize her. She dropped out the baptismal class and considered leaving the church. Outside the church, Marsha didn't enjoy her school or life. She didn't have many friends. The future seemed dreary. One day, Mother asked Marsha whether she would like to go to Zeokri Christian School, a Seventh-day Adventist day and boarding school. Marsha wanted a new start with new people, so she agreed to go. The summer before school started, she finally was baptized. At summer campus, she noticed that she seemed to be the only teen who wasn't baptized. She was baptized at 16, but life didn't change after baptism. She was the same person. The first few weeks at Zook were lonely. Marsha wasn't sure how to make friends. She felt sad. A theology student at Zook University, which is one of the same campus, noticed her loneliness and befriended her. "God knows our needs," he said. "He is nearby, and we can talk him like friends." Marsha didn't have many close friends, and she decided to try to talk to God. Finding a quiet place, she poured out her heart to God. "Forgive me for not talking to you for such long time," she said, weeping. "I'm sorry for not getting to know you. I was wrong to be angry with the pastor for not baptizing me." Peace flooded over her as she prayed. For the first time in her life, she felt that God was near. From that moment, life has not been the same before. I always longed for friends, she said. But now I have a friend that I can talk to at any time, and I don't need to look for him to talk. Part of this Quantas 13 Sabbath offering was helped Zawoki Christian School construct its own school building on the campus of Zawoki Adventist University. Currently, the school borrows classrooms from the university, and your offering will help the children meet in their own classrooms. Thank you for your listening. May God bless you.
Church, wherever you are, I want just to wake up all of you whenever you are in this health talk. My name is Gad Elum, and I'm here to present to you the health talk. But we shall pray before we start. Let us pray. Loving Father in heaven, we once again to thank you very much for the privilege of the Sabbath morning you have given to all of us. God, as we enter this session of health talk, we invite your presence to be with us, and I pray for all the program that will take place in the church. May be the guide of every program. That's my humble prayer. I ask of God, in the name of Jesus, I pray it. Amen. Once more, I again just want to welcome again these sessions about Health Talk. We have been talking about hair, skin in the last session that we have studied here. But today it's a little bit different. As you can able to see here, we shall learn about something new. And actually, last week, many people came to me. They were asking me about how somebody can reduce weight. Not all about weight. Some people, they think that they have actually the good weight. But if we just do assessment, we find out all of us have actually some problems. Today, this morning, we shall learn how you can either know that you have actually the good weight, and I will focus on the fats that actually store in your stomach. It's very simple to know whether your fat that you have in your stomach is okay. It does not need a lot of things to use. Just what you need is meter. I have meter here, the one just they use tearing machine there. This meter, it has got inch and centimeters, but I think in Uganda we shall use centimeter to weigh the amount of fat that's stored in our stomach. It's very simple, we shall do experiment. And I have here some remedy. Actually, it's a home remedy. We don't need to go to buy expensive drug in the pharmacy, in the hospital. You can actually use something you have at home. I know this
It's blackjack. It's everywhere. Very cheap. Actually, in Indian pharmacy, if you are to buy the medicine that comes from this herbal, it's very expensive. But we can be able to access wherever we are. Actually, in Uganda, it's a plant. I've just picked this when I was coming. It's a plant. I have here celery. In French, you call it celery. But I think even English is celery. So this also, it's common in vegetable and cooking. Just, it's also common. And also, I have here tomato. It's also something simple. These things, if I'm to make a medicine from these three ingredients, it can be very expensive. But we shall learn how we can use at home to treat yourself. I'll just stand and I will show you how we can able to determine the amount of fat that are stored in your stomach. What you have to do is something simple. You have to look at your stomach. I was asking my friend, do you know where stomach starts from? He said here. It's not here. Stomach started from this lower point of this side. What you need to determine is to determine the lowest level, I mean the lowest part of your stomach and the mid point. We shall use this formula of waist and hip ratio to determine amount of fat that are stored in the stomach. I have a here meter and I will just take on my side on just on my stomach and I will determine the lowest part of my stomach. As you can see, if I pump my stomach, this part becomes big and this one becomes small. So the lowest point of your stomach is this side. And the biggest point or mid point of your stomach is this side. What we shall do? We shall take the ratio of the waist and we divide by the hip. So for the men and women, the difference. If you are below 0.95 as a man, this means that your fat that are deposited in your stomach, it's okay, it's fine. But if you go beyond, this means there is a lot of risk, there is a lot of probability for you to get problems like heart disease, diabetes, and so much more. And you know that most of these lifestyle diseases, they are a result of what we take in our daily life. So we have to know, what am I taking? Is it okay? Does it increase the fats in my stomach? Very simple as this. I will just determine the lowest part of my stomach. It's this side. Bam. So at home, it's better you remove the t-shirt so that this one will not affect the way the measurement of your centimeters. And as you can see, I will just, let me check what I have. The lowest part of my stomach is, it's here. So I have 27, I record my 27 somewhere. So that when I'm taking my measurement, I will not forget. I will write somewhere, but let me write on my just on my mind. Therefore, after I will determine the midpoint of my stomach. Midpoint of my stomach, it's here. So I'm gonna again take the measurement of the midpoint. Here I've got 27. Don't forget. So I have 29 something point one. So I'm gonna calculate whether my fat in the stomach is okay. If I've told you if it is beyond 0.95, this means I have a problem about fat. So I have to make sure that I do something to reduce the weight the fat that I have here. So I will take my calculator, then I've got 27 and 29. I calculate what I have. So 27 divided by 29.3, I think. So this means I have 0.92. This means my stomach has a little bit amount of fat which is not needed. Of course, there is moderate. Moderate, it's all about 0.95. So I'm in moderate. If I go beyond this 0.95, this means in a period of maybe 20 or 30 years, I will have some problems about heart or some hypertension. So this means this 0.92, I'm safe here. I'm safe. So for the range of women, as I've told you, it's 0.85. For a man, it's 0.9. So This is how we calculate the fats that are stored in your belt of your stomach. So now you can ask, how then can we reduce amount of fat? Maybe if you determine that your fat that are deposited in your stomach is too much, how shall we do? Something simple. That's why I've brought here these three ingredients. Here it's blackjack. I think you can just call it in your respective language, the way you can call it, but it's common. I think in Uganda, they told me it's a... Yeah, thank you, Sari. Yeah. In Kinyarwanda, they call it Nyawarasani. That's something which is common in all over the world. So what should I do? These things, you have to take this. In early morning, you boil it. You boil them with the water. Actually, don't mind about how much ratio of water you have to add in this blackjack. So long as you just you put this in water and you boil them, it will automatically change the color and it will become a little bit like tea. What you have to take, if you're a fan of sugar, you can add honey. But if you don't have any problem about the sweetness of the things, you can take as it is. What does it do this? You see people who has got this diabetes and the high blood pressure, the things is here. You see, the blood transmit in a tube. Let me call it a tube, but it's a vein. So when you take a lot of product that are rich in the fats, those fats, they go and they deposit on the wall of the vein. So they, your heart, which transmit the blood entire your body, it fight by pushing the fat just for transmitting the blood. That's why you see people, they have high blood pressure. It means the heart is pumping a lot of blood so that it can reach an entire part of the body. That's why this, what it do? It melt the fat in your blood. It melt the fats that are deposited in your vein of the body. So this one is common, brethren. You can start just using this plant because it is available. Then it is very wonderful and very good because tomato has got what you call lycopene. Lycopene is the one compound that which is antioxidant. Antioxidant is even given the name of vitamin C. Vitamin C is the one which has proved that it fights even the risk of cancer. It improves the immune system. So once you have the immune system which is so balanced, this means there is a low risk of even increasing weight. What do we do is this. You take a drink, this tomato, you boil in water. When you boil in water, this skin of the tomato, it becomes soft. You can able to remove. The reason I'm removing this is because we see when you're making, when you're growing this tomato, we just apply this chemical and the pesticide, which also have found that it's not okay. So what you have to do is at least to reduce the amount of chemical in the tomato here. So what I will do, I'll just remove this skin, which always have even got this amount of chemicals. Therefore, after, if you have got the chance to have blender at home, you can blend this. Then in early morning, don't add salt, don't add anything, just dilute in water. It's best to use warm water because your body temperature is 37, 36 up to 37 something. If you take cold water in the morning, you are reducing the your just you are giving something at your body which is not favorable temperature of your body. That's why we recommend people to use at least the warm water. Then you drink this. Believe me that after 2 hours you will feel hungry. Why? Because this compound has gone direct to the blood and it have melted all the things. So you even automatically want to go to a restaurant. The reason is things have been washed from your body. So these are another things you can use at your home and which is very effective actually. The rest one is celery. This one is amazing. If you go to Indian dishes, this is the thing that they actually like to use. I don't know whether in Uganda also the people love this, but this is amazing plant that you can ever use. Still the same process that you call immersion. Just you take this, you boil in water, therefore after you leave it to cool a bit, then you drink. After you drink, automatically when you have taken in empty stomach, you will automatically need to go to restroom. The reason is here is that this has gone dead to the blood and have washed all unnecessary things, so it have to go out. That's the what it does in your body. So lastly, as I'm concluding, you can take these combinations. Why not? Just you take this tomato, you boil, you remove the skin, you chop them into smaller pieces. Thereafter, after, you take this blackjack, you remove this, I don't know how I can call this, maybe fluorescence or something like flower, this one, because our target is these leaves. Then again, you boil in water, you take your cereal, again, you boil after washing them, then you leave this in warm water, Then after burying them, you put in your cup, you drink. Please, I recommend you this. It's not something from somewhere, it's been researched from, and there is conclusion about this. For my info, you can just visit internet about maybe the side effect and how to use cerate or black jaguar tomato for weight reduction. I believe that you have enjoyed this home remedy, and you will benefit. Let us, as an Adventist, we just use natural things, because natural things has got the little or the minor side effect when you compare to the processed things. Things which I want to conclude is, if you want to reduce weight, there's something you have to avoid. First, things which are processed, including rice, this portion, that one just it affects the increase of weight, because there's something they add there which again increase the weight. Something like food that rich in oil, for example, Rolex, chapati, these things, it's not recommended for some people who want even to reduce weight. Meat, eggs, gin nut, again, those things that are also not recommended for the people who want to make sure that they balance their bare fat in their stomach. May God bless you as we started to implement what you always learn. And I believe that we shall get more, and we shall get good health at the end. May God bless you, and I wish you again Happy Sabbath. Thank you.
Good morning, Gugema SDA. Good morning, everyone. Happy Sabbath. We want to thank God who has given us life up to this time. And this time is for the lesson discussion. I believe every one of us has their lesson quarterly. Please get hold of your lesson quarterlies and the Bible, and let us study together or remind ourselves of what we have studied through the week. Just before we go deep into everything, allow me to request my brother to pray.
Let us pray. Our dear God and Father who art in heaven, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, once again, dear Lord, we want to thank you for this day. We thank you for the life that you have given unto us. And above all, we thank you for your daily providences. At this time, as we're going to be going through the lesson, dear Lord, we pray that may Holy Spirit be with us. Guide us up until the end of this lesson. This is my humble and honest prayer. In Christ Jesus, I pray thee. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much At this time, I want to introduce the people that I am with up here. On my right hand side is Sister Pastor Isabella Kemonto, a lecturer in the School of Theology. Sister, you may greet the church.
Happy Sabbath.
Thank you so much. On my left is Brother Rion. He's a pastor and a student in the School of Theology. Brother, you may greet the church.
God is good
all the time.
Thank you so much for joining us for lesson discussion. Just before we go into lesson discussion, I want to bring a report about the 13th Sabbath. This quarter, our mission stories, as you have heard, are coming to us from Euro-Asia Division. And Euro-Asia Division is home to 330.4 million people, including 107,252 Adventists. And this gives us a ratio of one Adventist for every 3,080 people. You see, that ratio is quite big. For every 3,080 people, there is only one Adventist in this division. So we are called upon to organize our 13th Sabbath offering to support this division to grow. In this quarter, our 13th Sabbath offering will go to two projects, one in Russia and another in Bucha. Now, these two projects, they seem to be similar. The 13th Sabbath offering will go to help in the construction of a three-story building in Russia. This three-story building will accommodate the preschool, the secondary school, and the elementary school in the Adventist Center of Higher Learning in Russia. And the same in Bucha, it will be like that. They are going to construct another building there, a two-story building, also to support the schools in that area. And these schools are the ones that train the missionaries. So we are appealing to you to prepare your faithful 13th Sabbath offering to support these two projects for God's mission. Thank you so much, and that marks the end of it, and then we dive into the lesson discussion. This quarter, our lesson is entitled, Isaiah, Comfort My People. Last week, we looked at the lesson number 3, which was entitled, When Your World is Falling Apart. When Your World is Falling Apart. One thing I learned from there is that Emmanuel, God with us. Even when our worlds are falling apart, God is with us. So we have nothing to fear. In this week, we looked at the hard way. That is the title of our lesson this week. I want to request Brother Rion to remind us of the mission, the memory text of our lesson this week. Brother Rion.
Our memory text is coming from the book of Isaiah, chapter 8, reading it from verse number 17, and I'll read it in the New King James Version. The Bible says, I will wait on the Lord, who hides his face from the house of Jacob, and I will hope in him.
Thank you so much, Brother Rion. How would you relate the two? The title of the lesson, The Hard Way, and the memory text.
Perhaps let's start by analyzing the verse itself.
Okay, thank you.
Isaiah starts by saying, I will wait. He makes it personal by using the personal pronoun there, I. In other words, he's simply saying, when it comes to the things of salvation, it's not a matter of what you do as a church, but this is something that is personal. And he says, I personally, he takes a personal conviction and he takes a personal oath that if no one else will do it, he himself will do it. And he says, I will wait. The aspect of waiting involves a lot of things. By the time we speak of waiting, one needs to know that waiting involves patience. You cannot wait without patience. Waiting involves sacrifice. Waiting simply means that you have faith in whom you are waiting in. So Isaiah is simply saying, as I am waiting, I am confident that the God I'm waiting for will arrive at the appointed time. He's simply saying that irregardless of what we are facing in life, we will wait. Even if others run to their prophets, others might run to their ancestors, others might run to, you know, out of church, but we will wait unto the Lord. And that's the message that we are getting. We ought to wait unto the Lord. For us to survive this hard way, one must learn how to wait.
Thank you so much, Brother Leon. The lesson writer brought to us a story of a blind girl. The blind girl that was caught up by fire on the fourth floor of a building. And remember, she's blind, so she could not go anywhere. But she was perched near the window, and she kept waiting. Nobody could command her, and she could listen. But she waited for the voice of the Father.
Yes.
And the moment she heard the voice of the Father, she recognized that that is my Father. And whatever He says, I will do, because I am comfortable with what He says. He means well for me. And when He commanded jump, she jumped comfortably, and none of her limbs was broken because she was comfortable. She knew the voice of the Father. Do we know the voice of our Father? That when He's talking in the time of turmoil in our lives, can we recognize that this is the voice of my Father? So I've got to listen, and I've got to answer according to what it is saying to me. Sister Isabella, do you have anything to say about the introduction?
Yeah, the lesson teaches us a lot. And one of the things that the lesson is teaching us, that we must trust our God.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The way the girl trusted the Father, that she could release herself, we must also trust God. That the moment we hear His voice, we just release ourselves. Whatever the circumstances will be, God will take us in His hands.
Thank you so much, Sister Isabella. We want to go to Sunday, and Sunday was entitled Prophecy Fulfilled. Prophecy Fulfilled. Which kind of prophecy was fulfilled? Last week we looked at Ahaz, and I believe here we also looked at Ahaz, Tigrath, Pelissa the Third. Sister Rion, tell us more about this prophecy that was fulfilled.
All right, so Isaiah chapter number 7 starts with the introduction of Emmanuel himself.
Okay.
There's a promise that there is going to be a son who is going to come and die for His people. But in the same chapter, we also see another prophecy which was fulfilled. And that was the prophecy of the destruction of Israel because of their disobedience. And hence, when I look at the chapter, I summarize it into two.
Okay.
We have the first promise of redemption, which is about Emmanuel, the one who is coming. But at the same time, we also have the prophecy of destruction, which is about the destruction that God is about to bring through the Assyrians to this nation which has decided to go against God. So in these two things, we see that whenever God brings judgment, He always brings it when it's mixed with grace. Whenever God is about to punish His people, He doesn't do it out of anger, but He does it out of love. So as much as He assures them that the Assyrians are coming to destroy you because you disobeyed me, but again, be of good cheer, because I will send a Redeemer, Emmanuel himself, God who is with us. So we are seeing prophecies being fulfilled, the prophecy of redemption and also the prophecy of destruction.
Thank you so much, Sister Isabella. Would you like to add anything?
I really don't have much to add on this.
Okay.
But we need to realize that whatever God has said, it will be fulfilled.
Amen.
Thank you.
It does
so much.
Not matter when, but if God is telling us to obey Him, we must obey Him. The children of Israel were destroyed because they did not listen to God.
Okay.
So we must be ready to listen to God.
Thank you so much, Sister. We want to move on to Monday. Four sin consequences. Four sin consequences. Here my eyes quote a verse in Psalms 118, verse 9. Brother Rion, could you read it for me? Psalms 118, verse 9. 118 verse 9. You may open your Bibles, church.
Psalms 118.
118 verse 9.
Verse number 9. I'll read it in the New King James Version.
Okay.
The Bible says, it is better to trust in the Lord than to put your confidence in princes.
Okay. Thank you so much. It is better to trust in the Lord. This simply means that there is a message that God has given you before the experience that you are facing now. And it is better to take refuge in your Lord before you face this situation as a person, or before you consult with your friend. It is better to take your refuge in the Lord. The foreseen consequences, they come after the message of the Lord has been before you. Yes. Sister Isabella, would you tell us what the foreseen consequences meant in this lesson?
King Ahasa was instructed by God.
Okay. Yeah.
But he did not trust God. Mm-hmm. Instead, he trusted humanity.
Okay. Mm.
He trusted having alliance with the humanity. Mm. And at the end of it, he lost it. In fact, the lesson tells us that he was not given a glorious burial. He was buried, and the people were disgusted even the way he was buried. But even we look at other people who have not trusted God, people like King Saul, the first king of Israel, he did not trust God, and he ended up losing the kingdom.
Okay.
And so what we see from the lesson is that when you don't trust God, when you don't put your trust in God, you lose it. And that is a consequence. The second thing that we can get from there, that when you don't trust in God, when you don't have faith in God, you lose focus. And so instead of hearing God speaking, you get confused. And you sometimes may be following something different instead of following God. So it is important that to avoid those consequences which will come in us losing confidence in God, we focus on God. We focus on trusting God. And number three, when we focus on God, we receive God's blessings.
Amen.
Because King David focused on God. Even when he wanted to build the temple, he decided to consult God. And God told him, instead, I am going to make you a house of dynasty. If we trust in God, we will receive God's blessings the way King David received the blessings. Okay. But if we don't trust in God, we will lose the blessings that God has prepared for us.
Thank you so much, Sister Isabella. Brother Rion, the way we receive trust, or we put trust in God, what can we do about our parents, our friends? Do we mistrust them, or what do we do with their advices?
All right. The Bible tells us that we should trust in God. But again, God can reveal himself through our family members. So there are times where God speaks to us, perhaps not directly, but through those who are around us.
Okay.
So when the word of the Lord, like in this case, Isaiah went and he spoke to them, they ought to trust in the words which Isaiah was speaking.
Okay.
Because God was speaking through Isaiah himself. But the fundamental thing that we are learning is that we should never be dependent upon human beings, because only God is immutable. Only God can be trusted fully. Only God is the only one who does not let his children go. And hence he promises us in scripture that he will never forsake us nor leave us. That is an assurance from a God who has not sinned. Sometimes it's difficult to trust human beings because we are sinners by flesh. But otherwise, when we trust in God, we are rest assured that everything will go according to plan.
Okay. Thank you so much. I want to request Sister Isabella to read for me 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 18. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 18. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 18. Are you there?
Yes, I
am. Okay, now wait.
Just a second.
Second Corinthians chapter 4, verse 18.
Yeah. Okay. The book of Second Corinthians, chapter 4, verses 18. And I am going to read from the New King James Version.
Okay.
The word of God says, while we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal.
Yes, and this verse only brings to us faith. Faith. We need to have faith for us to look and to fix our eyes on the things that are not seen. And the things are not, that are not seen are the spiritual things. We need to fix our eyes on the spiritual things for us to move on in this world. We want to go to part Tuesday, which is entitled, What is in a Name? What is in a name? Now, this is an interesting part because we all have names. We all have names. Parents over there, what did you mean when you named your son or daughter that particular name that you gave them? What does it mean? Or you just picked a name of a celeb, and then you fixed it on your child. Some people these days have given name Corona. This one, because he's born during the Corona pandemic, the child is called Corona. That is what they mean. What did you mean, or what does your name mean? Now, last week, we looked at Isaiah's son, who God told him to go with to King Ahaz. And the name Shear Jashab meant the remnant shall return. What does your name mean? Brother Rion, what is in a name? Which name and whose name?
In fact, the lesson here has a very interesting name. Mahel Shal Hal Baz. Imagine having such a long name. By the time the Hebrews were giving names, names were always given with some significance. Because the name itself, it does not only define the child, but it also prophesies upon the life of the child. So you'll find that when you name a child with a specific name, that child is most likely to live according to that name. And hence, when we look at Jacob, the thief himself, that is his name and that was his definition. And in his life, we see his crookedness. However, when we come to Rachel, when Rachel was naming the child Benjamin after she had given birth, she said, your name shall be called Benoni, because you are a child of my pain. In other words, she was limiting the child to her pain. But the father immediately stood up and said, you cannot limit my child to what you've experienced. And immediately he changed the name and he said, you shall be called Benjamin, the son of my strength. So we are seeing the power which rests upon a name. And hence, that's why the Bible tells us that there's no any other name that is given upon which man can be saved, apart from the name of Jesus himself. In the Hebrew, they tried to get God a name. His name is called Hayah, or perhaps you call him Yahweh. We call it Tetragrammaton. This is the four-letter name of God, which cannot be pronounced by human beings. And when we call upon this name, indeed God comes to our rescue. When you call upon the name of Israel, God comes to our rescue. And hence, because God comes to us in different ways, we also have different names for him. So you hear others calling him Jehovah Jireh, then you know that he has provided for them. Others will call him Jehovah Rapha, you know that he has healed them somewhere. Others will call them Jehovah El Shaddai, then you'll know that he is sufficient to them. So a name in itself must have meaning. And hence, by the time you call the name of God, be aware that you are not just calling a name, but you are summoning the divine God himself.
Thank you so much, Brother Rion. I remember some time back in my life when I was experiencing a turmoil in my life, and only the word that kept me going was, the Lord is my shepherd.
Amen.
The Lord is my shepherd. Amen. In that name, Lord, there was power. Because each time I mentioned that verse, I felt like water was poured on a hot charcoal. So I felt calm. I was able to go through because there is power in that name. Our sister Isabella, what do you have to say about the name?
I just want to remind ourselves that this has not been said for the first time.
Mm-hmm.
This was again said some time back. What is behind a name?
Yes.
A name is very powerful, for it portrays the character of somebody. And you will see all through the Bible, the characters that we are being given comes from their names. A name portrays the destiny of somebody.
Yep.
A name gives the personality. And so when we hear Emmanuel, God is with us. That is behind the name. So a name is very, very, very important. And that is very important to us today. We need to be very careful about the names we give to our children.
Yeah, true.
The name we call people, especially the educators. Sometimes you call those you are educating useless, good for nothing. We are making those people to own up what we have told them. Because behind a name, there's a lot of power. We must also guard our names, the integrity of our names, because the Bible says a good name is better than riches. And so we must also guard our names, because a name is very important in our lives.
Thank you so much, Sister Isabella. Part Wednesday is entitled, Nothing to Fear When We Fear God Himself. This reminded me of Spirit of Prophecy, Ellen White, where she says, we have nothing to fear for the future unless as we forget how God has led us in the past. So nothing to fear when we fear God himself. Brother Leon, I want to know, there's a verse that says, love drives out fear. Yeah, how do we relate fear with love? Yeah, when I love my parent, again, how do you tell me to fear my parent?
Perhaps maybe we've misunderstood the definition of fear itself.
Okay.
A certain guy decided to do some research upon the word fear, and he visited a lot of libraries trying to understand what fear means in the other biblical languages. And he could not find a perfect definition for it until he went to Egypt, and when he visited the pharaohs, they told him that this word fear that you're speaking of is somehow associated with eyes. It has something to do with eyes. And hence, from that perspective, I can therefore say that by the time the Bible says fear God, it simply means acknowledge his presence. There are some things you can't do in the presence of some people. For example, a child can't be not in the presence of the mother, not because of anything, but because the mother is present. And as before you act, perhaps as a Christian, you should also acknowledge that you are in the presence of God. And when you acknowledge the presence of God, you are by default fearing God, because it simply means you are going to obey him. It simply means you are going to praise him. It simply means you are going to worship him, not because you are afraid of him, but because you've acknowledged his presence. So fear has nothing to do with being frightened and running away. But fear has something to do with feeling welcomed and feeling at home in the presence of God himself.
Okay, thank you so much. I want to give Sister Isabella a minute to talk about fear of God.
The fear of God we are talking about is recognizing God as the ultimate authority.
Okay.
It's recognizing God that he is in control. Because when we know that God is in control, there's nothing to fear. Because even if we go through circumstances in life, even if we go through challenges in life, we know God is in control. And that's why the book of Psalms 46 verse 10 says, be still and know that I am God.
Yes.
And because God is in control, we have nothing to fear. Because unless he gives permission, nothing will touch us. It is only that when we fear, we sometimes want to run away from God. We want to do things because we are fearing that God is not in control. And that is not what we are being advised to do. We are to let God be God and be in control of our lives.
Thank you so much, Sister Isabella. We need to fear God, we need to respect God, we need to adore him, we need to recognize his presence in our situations. Our part Thursday is entitled, Groom of the Ungrateful Living Dead. People who do not want to be connected to God in anything are referred to as living dead. Are referred to as living dead, because in God we find life. So if you are not connected to God in any way, then you are a living dead person. Brother Rion, tell us more about the living dead who are ungrateful.
All right, so here we're given the story of Ahaz, and his story becomes painful because after deciding to trust in men, eventually he reaped the consequences of his own decision. Perhaps let me make a point there and say that every sin has a price tag.
Okay.
There's no sin that is cheap. Sin is expensive for both the one who sins and the one who commits. It's only free for the one who avoids it.
Okay.
So we see Ahaz here experiencing the consequences of his own sin. And after he died, for sure, this is when you realize that life is only found in obedience. When you do not obey God, you are as good as a dead man. So after he died out of disobedience, he was not even buried together with the tombs of the other kings of Israel, because people looked down upon him. People saw him as nothing. The same people who were following him are the same people who are despising him. Let me also make a point there and say, it is dangerous to follow your leaders. And that is why the Bible tells us that look unto Jesus, because he's the author and the finisher of your faith. If you focus on individuals, when they fall, you'll fall with them. Ahaz fell and they fell together. They are now regretting, but Ahaz is dead, but they are in a bad situation where they cannot reverse the condition which they are in. And hence it is paramount that when we live as Christians, we should stop justifying our own sins using the sins of others, particularly when your sins are committed by certain elders in church or perhaps the deacons of this church, and you start thinking, perhaps if he could do it, why not me? You'll end up like this nation, because when those leaders die, you'll have God and yourself together facing judgment, and you'll have nothing to do. So the lesson that we're getting from Thursday is that Ahaz disobeyed God, and he was as good as a dead man.
Okay. Thank you so much. Sister Isabella, can you bring it down to our experiences?
The lesson is talking about the living dead.
Yes.
Can you imagine? We are living, but somehow we could be dead. Because if I am living in sin, I am a walking corpse. Because I am not living spiritually. We need to think about it seriously, because we could be in church day after day, we could be worshiping God, we could be working for God, but we are not there. We are just walking corpses that will perish anytime.
Thank you so much, Sister Isabella. Brothers and sisters, we have all looked at this lesson this week, and we need not to leave it to this week. I usually tell people that the lesson books that we hold in our hands as a church, they do not expire. There's no time that, because the date passed, because this lesson was for the other year, and the date was January, we are in March, so that one has expired. It doesn't expire. We can always revisit and study our lessons so that we can be guided by the Holy Spirit. So I want to give just a minute to my friends to give us a take-home message. What did you take from the lesson? What do you leave with the church as a take-home message? Brother Rion.
One thing we should remember is that Christianity is not an easy road, and hence the lesson is saying a hard way. But it is only hard when we neglect the power of God in our lives.
Okay.
But when we involve God in our lives, like the psalmist will say, he will say, even though I may walk through the valleys of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. David understood very well that a shadow can only exist in the presence of light. And it is only defined by the presence of light. And hence, in the absence of light, there cannot be any shadow.
Okay.
So what he was simply saying is that when the righteousness of God shines in your life, you are made aware of the shadows around you. But because of those shadows, you are rest assured that if I can see these shadows, it simply means that God is there. And hence, Isaiah says that I will wait upon the Lord, the one who hides his face
I'll wait upon him. In other words, I'll be patient with him. I will not get annoyed. I will not run to prophets. I will not run to my ancestors. I won't run anywhere, but I'll wait. So as we are going to be contemplating upon this message, if there's something that we need to keep in mind, let us learn to wait upon the Lord.
Thank you so much, Sister Isabella. Take home message.
I have about three take home messages.
Thank you.
Number one, God does not hide from us.
Mm-hmm.
It is us who hides from God.
Mm.
The circumstances, our sinful nature,
mm.
the way we are looking at what is happening in our lives,
mm.
makes us to lose focus on God.
Mm.
And we see like God is not with us.
Mm.
But we have been told God is with us.
Amen.
So God does not go away from us. It is us who go away from God.
Mm.
Number two, we have seen from the lesson about learning in a hard way,
mm.
or in a hard way.
Mm.
The children of Israel refused to listen to God, and they had to get it in a hard way when they were taken by the Assyrians. So they were taken into captivity because they did not learn.
Mm.
As Christians, we need to learn when God speaks to us so that we don't learn in a hard way.
Mm.
And number three.
Number three.
Mm. This is something that it is spoken in on Friday.
Mm.
Helen White says that the spirit of spiritualism, the idea of consulting mystical powers, it is dripping into the church, and it is becoming a problem in the church. We need to be very careful, because when we don't trust God and we trust in the spiritual world, we trust on other people, we trust on what the mystical powers are giving us, we are losing focus.
True.
And this is what Helen White has said in the book of Great Controversy, page 556. So as we continue discussing our lesson, let's remember that our God is in control. Our God is with us. Let's not look at the outside, let's look at what God is speaking to us.
Amen.
May God bless you.
Thank you so much, Sister Isabella. Thank you, Brother Rion. And my take-home message is, let us learn to identify the voice of our Father. In every situation, God will be speaking to us. And if we don't know His voice, we will not recognize that this is the voice of my Father.
Yeah.
And when we hear the voice of our Father, we need to obey. Let us not listen to the many voices in the world that are speaking to us. We need to learn. We need to ask God to teach us how to identify His tender small voice.
Amen.
In all our situations, God will be speaking to us. And if we don't know His voice, we will not know the message that He has brought to us. Let us pray about it, and God is willing to give it to us. So before we pray, this is the end of our lesson, but I want to remind you that if you did not get yourself a copy of the lesson this quarter, there are lessons at the container there near Brother Mira's container, but the next shop, there are some lesson quarterlies. You can afford to get yourself a copy at only 3,000 shillings. Thank you so much for staying with us in the lesson discussion. May you take the lessons and apply them individually. Thank you. May I ask Sister Isabella to pray for us as we go.
Shall we pray? Our most gracious Father in heaven, we thank you. We thank you, Father, for speaking to us through the lesson. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for reminding us what we ought to do and what we need to do. Thank you, Father, because you have promised that you will not do anything without letting us know. Heavenly Father, thank you for hearing our prayers. Thank you for answering our prayers.
Amen.
For this we pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
Sabbath, everyone. Happy day. This is the ransom not serving before you. But before we start, I'll ask my fellow ministers to introduce themselves.
Happy Sabbath, brethren. Happy Sabbath, brethren. My name is Jingo Andrew, and I'm in the School of Earth Sciences, Gama University. A member of Ransom Notes.
Happy Sabbath. Sabiti Benjamin is my name. I'm in the School of Education, majoring in Math and Physics.
Amen. Yeah, Mwanika Joel, in the School of also Health Sciences, doing Nutrition.
I'm David Setupa, School of Nursing, Bugema University. With that, we shall humble ourselves and pray before we start our song service. Let us pray. Our loving Father in heaven, we thank you for the gift of life. We thank you for the Sabbath school that we have just been part of. Now, as we go into our song service and divine, may you send the Holy Spirit to guide us in worshiping you in spirit and truth. In thy name I pray.
Amen.
We shall start our song service with hymn number 294 that says, Power in the Blood. 294, there is power in the blood.
There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you be free from the burdens of sin? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for the cleansing to cover his tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you do service for Jesus your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you do daily praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Amen. We shall have a special item from the ransom notes.
There was a man, they called him Jesus, walked the shores of Galilee. He healed the sick and calmed the waters, made the blind eyes to see. He raised the dead and cleansed the lepers, had the power to set them free. Even most of all, he went to Calvary, bled and died for you and me. Walk like Jesus, talk like Jesus. I want to be just like my Lord. Help my neighbors, all these labors. I want my life to spread his word.
I want to
I want to sing, to hear the word. I want to tell the world about His love. Walk like Jesus, talk like Jesus. I want to be just like my Lord. I wish that I would have been with Him when He stepped out of the sea. I hear Him say to Simon Peter, come my servant, follow me. What soon that dawn shall fall before us, and as face we shall behold. Oh, what a time we'll have together, shouting down the streets of gold. Walk like Jesus, talk like Jesus. I want to be just like my Lord. Help my neighbors on His labors. I want my life to spend His word. I want to sing, to hear the word. I want to tell the world about His love. Walk like Jesus, talk like Jesus. I want to be just like my Lord. Walk like Jesus, talk like Jesus. I want to be just like my Lord. Walk like Jesus, talk like Jesus. I want to be just like my Lord.
Amen. Amen. We shall go on with our song service with hymn number 195, Showers of Blessing. 195, Showers of Blessing.
There shall be showers of blessing. This is the promise of life. There shall be seasons refreshing, sent from the Savior above. Showers of blessings, showers of blessings we need. Mercy drops out as a showers we plead. There shall be showers of blessing, precious saved and healed again. Over the hills and the valleys, sons of the sinners and men. Showers of blessing, showers of blessings we need. Mercy drops down the
again. Praise God once again. We shall proceed with hymn number 184. Hymn number 184, Jesus paid it all. 184.
Jesus paid it all. Him, we shall have another special from the Ransom Notes.
Change my heart.
whole again. Change my heart, whole again.
You are the potter, and I am the clay. Just make me and mold
me
again. When I wake up every day, I just get on all my knees to pray, asking you to give me strength to get my way. Father, create me a clean heart. This is my heart of prayer.
Mold me
again.
Change my heart. Make me whole again.
Change my
heart. Whole again.
The potter, and I am the clay. Just make me and
mold me
again.
Oh,
change my heart.
Make me whole again.
Change my heart.
Make me whole again.
You are the potter, and I am the clay. Just make me and
mold me
again.
Again,
oh, change my heart, create me a clean heart, Father. Oh, oh, I wanna be with you.
We shall proceed with hymn number 181, Does Jesus Care? 181, Does Jesus Care? Does Jesus Care?
Does Jesus Care? When my heart is faint to devotion and song, and the burdens pressed, and the cares distressed, and the way grows weary.
Days are weary and
Hark the voice of Jesus calling. 359. Hark the voice of Jesus calling.
Now we move.
watu makunganya ebibala kutusa enko melero o lisa nyuka muye o muko nguzi o mukulu aimu kama wabiona Chisela chitu se Lord of harvest and for creepers Hear us Lord to thee we'll cry Send them now the sheep to gather in the harvest time pass by Tumaba Tumu Nimiro e Chisela Chi to say
Amen. Amen. We shall go on with our song service with hymn number 159, The Ragged Cross.
I'll flee to the old rugged
dear members, both in here in this congregation and somewhere online, I greet you all in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy
and happy day.
Happy
we certainly praise God for a moment like this one, when we still are able to breathe and able to move, and even more than that, to come in the presence of the Lord as people called by his name. Glory be to his name.
Amen.
At present, I have a few announcements. These are wedding announcements. Mr. Tazuba Alex Waiswa, a member of Jerusalem SDA Church, Central Uganda Conference, Uganda, son of Mr. and Mrs. Paul and Lydia Tazuba of Rucham Village, Bamunanika County, Ruwero District, Uganda, is going to be wedded in holy matrimony with Ms. Namukisa Silivia, a member of Senero SDA Church, Central Uganda Conference, Uganda, daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Moses and Florence Sekaganda of Masanafu Village, Rubaga Sub-County, Kampala District. The wedding will take place at SDA Church, Bugema University, Kampala, Uganda, on Friday, 29th January 2021 at 2 p.m. If anyone has a genuine reason why these two should not be joined in holy matrimony, let him or her speak now or forever keep silent. If there is anybody, you are free to raise up your hand, then we shall sort things out. But after now, take away your gossip. This one is an invitation. Mr. Kato Paul, a member of Entebbe Central SDA Church, Central Uganda Conference, Uganda, and Ms. Bira Edrin, a member of Hoima SDA Church, Western Uganda Field, hope to be wedded together here at Bugemba University Church tomorrow at 10. Everyone is welcome. Their wedding announcements are already complete, so I don't need to read the fifth. You are only invited to their wedding here at 10 tomorrow. Another wedding invitation, the family of Mr. and Mrs. Dodovic and Stefania Kigongo Yiga of Runyodia Village, Single County, Mitiana District, together with the family of Mr. and Mrs. Waswa and Jane Mugumbianyonyi of Bwesa Village, Babenge Sub-County, Karungu District, with great pleasure invite the company of Bugema University Church to the holy matrimony of their children, Mulindwa David and Namayengo Gertrude, due to take place here tomorrow at SDA Church at 12 noon, and thereafter to their reception at Bugema Adventist Secondary School at 2 p.m. We look forward to seeing you with pleasure. For our call to worship, we turn to Psalms 100. A psalm of thanksgiving. The psalmist says, make a joyful shout to the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before him, his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful to him and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations. May God bless you as we continue to worship together. I think the deacons and deaconesses, it is not yet time for offerings. We shall follow the order of service as it is, as it will be indicated. Thank you. May God bless you as we worship.
Good afternoon, church. I request you to stand up. Yes, good morning, church. It is still morning, sorry. I request you to stand up and we sing our intro, hymn 694, Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Let us bow our heads in prayer. Eternal God, our Heavenly Father, we lift our voices in praise of your name, in thanksgiving for the great things that you've done unto us throughout this week and even the days before. We want to thank you that today is Sabbath, when you bring us together again to worship you, to praise you and learn of you. We pray that as we continue to tabernacle with you, we'll feel your leading, we'll feel your spirit, and also your blessings upon us. Now have your way in your lives, and may we come to the end of this day, and particularly this service, praising and glorifying you for your goodness and mercy towards each one of us. For this is our prayer and thanksgiving in Jesus' name.
Amen.
We shall all stand up for our song, the opening song, as hymn number 508, Anywhere with Jesus I Can Safely Go.
Anywhere with Jesus I can safely go, anywhere he leads me in this world. Dearest joys would fade. Anywhere with Jesus I am not afraid. Anywhere, anywhere, fear I cannot know. Anywhere with Jesus I can safely go. Anywhere
bring our key text. We can have our Bibles. We can have our Bibles. Or let's have our seat first. Then we can take our Bibles. Let's have our Bibles, and we're reading from the book of Ruth. Ruth, the first chapter. Ruth, chapter 1, and verses 1 to verse 3. Ruth, and chapter 1, verses 1 to verse 3. I'm reading from the revised version, and the Bible says, "In the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land. And a certain man of Bethlehem in Judah went to sojourn the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons. The name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife Naomi, and the names of his two sons were Maholon and Chilion. They were Ephrathites from Bethlehem in Judah. They went into the country of Moab and remained there. But Elimelech, the husband of Naomi, died, and she was left with her sons." I will read another verse from the book of John, chapter 16, and verses 33. John, chapter 16, and verses 33. The Bible goes ahead to say, "I have said this to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." I will repeat. "I have said this to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." May the Lord bless the reading of his word.
Amen. And wherever each one of us is, I want to request, if you are at home looking and worshiping with us online, and or you are here with us, kindly humble yourselves. Those who have where to kneel, we want to kneel together as we worship the Lord through prayer. Our most kind, loving heavenly God, we kneel before your presence this morning to worship you. We kneel as a sign of our acknowledgement that we are human beings kneeling before the God of the universe. Even the privilege to kneel before you is great. Who are we after all? The Bible talks about us as being mere worms. So how can mere worms come before the presence of their Lord except through his mercy? And so we praise you for your love, your kindness, your mercy upon us, that you have enabled us to call upon your name, which is far above us. But through the blood of Jesus, we can call upon that name in humility, but with great thankfulness. Thank you, Heavenly Father. First, we pray that you forgive our sins. We sin against you in many ways, in words, in thoughts, and in actions, different ways, different magnitudes, but all through sinning against you. Forgive and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And Lord, fill us with your Holy Spirit, that our worship of you may be in truth and in spirit. Many of us who are here, we have our people, we represent many people. Some of us are sick, and some of our people are sick physically. We pray, Heavenly Father, that you hear us according to the riches of your kindness. All of us are sick spiritually, that's why we are coming to you. Lord, you know the extent of our sinful sickness, each one of us individually and all of us collectively. Heavenly Father, we pray that you forgive and cleanse. And dear Father, at this moment, we lift into your hands the countries we represent, the communities we represent, the individuals and families we represent. As you bless us, bless them as well. We still continue to pray against this corona pandemic, which has ravaged the whole world. You are the only one who has a complete answer over that pandemic. And how you are to do it, you are the only one, the only wise and powerful God who knows what to do. We are praying, Heavenly Father, that you will take it away. The sooner, the better. We know that some people will worship you because they have seen it go away. Others, we know, they will say, praise God, we shall go to our normal routine of abuse of this privilege. But Lord, we pray that you take it away. And Heavenly Father, in a special way at this moment, we commit Bugema University into your hands and other institutions. We are wondering whether it is going to open normally, but we are in the abnormal now. But we pray that you will make it conducive, the situation conducive, so that it can open normally with face-to-face interaction between lecturers and students. And that's what we are praying for all other institutions likewise. Heavenly Father, many things we can ask for. We pray for this country and thank you for the elections that are going on. And so far, whatever has been done, we thank you. We pray that you continue to keep peace in this country, Uganda, where we are, and other countries all around us. Lord, bless your people and continue to draw us with your cords of love through the ministry of the Holy Spirit and your word and your servants who are working in different ways. Heavenly Father, once again, at this moment, I commit into your hands those whom you have prepared to minister the word to your people worldwide, beginning with those with Pastor Maka, who is going to minister to us in this congregation. Lord, may they disappear and may you appear. May they decrease as you increase. And may everybody who has worshipped you today and is listening and waiting for your word go home when they have been edified and been drawn closer to you, ready to face the world around us, around him or her, with strength and with courage to prevail. Thank you for all your blessings. They are innumerable, and we say thank you. Glory and praise be to your holy name. In Jesus' name, amen. Now time for tithes and offerings. And before we collect, and I want to encourage those who are also worshiping in your respective homes, that we still have as a church the system of returning tithes and offerings. And you may return them through the envelopes, those who are here, or you may do loose offerings, but we encourage using envelopes. And those who are worshiping outside in your homes, you may bring your offerings during the week, and you'll find the secretary in the new auditorium. There is an office then you can present your offerings there, or you may see any deacon who will, or the treasury office, or the elders whom you see, you can give your envelope and they will bring the money. It will be properly recorded and receipted, and then the envelope returned to you. 2 Corinthians 9 has this to say. 9 verse 6. But this I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. So let each one give as he purposes in his heart, but not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you, always having all sufficiency in all things, may have an abundance for every good work. God supplies bountifully, and out of what he has supplied, let us give also generously, because he loves a cheerful giver. Imagine if you were to be charged by the air you have been breathing, even since morning, however small the amount, how much you would pay. But all that is free. That is just one example, and there are many others. So let us count our blessings and give thanks offerings and every other offerings and return tithe faithfully, and God is able to continue enlarging our pockets, and may he enlarge our hearts, and that we return to him that which is due for his blessings, in Jesus' name.
Father and our God in heaven, we thank you for this moment that you've given us, your sons and daughters. It's an opportunity we count that we are still alive. Many have gone, but we are still here, and we want to thank you. Father, this is the little that your sons and daughters have managed to bring before you. We know that some have not managed, but we pray that you may enable them such that the next meeting they may be able to bring something. We pray, Lord, that you may add this onto the other collections elsewhere in the world so that it may do your work. Bless the hands that have given, and Father, bless us all. Enable us to be givers. We pray all this, believing and trusting in thy name.
Amen.
Thank you.
Sabbath Church. Happy Sabbath in different churches out there. Happy Sabbath. It's time for children's story. Children out there, I think you're watching, those who can be able to watch. I'm called Janet Maka with a children's story today. Our children's story comes from the book of Ruth, chapter 2, verse 2. And the title of our children's story is Active Love. Children out there, I think you can hear me, you can watch me. The title of our story is Active Love. It comes from Ruth, chapter 2, verse 2. Let's read there. One day, Ruth said to Naomi, "Let me go to the fields to gather the corn that the harvest workers leave. I'm sure to find someone who will let me work with him." Naomi answered, "Go ahead, my daughter." Children, Ruth showed love to her mother-in-law. Children, as you know, this story of Ruth. Naomi was a mother-in-law to Ruth, but Ruth loved her mother-in-law so much that she reached a point of saying that she will go with her to Bethlehem, that she will stay with her, that she will live with her, and that she will die where she will die. When we show love to other people, those people don't remain the same. They return that love to us, and they also share love to others. I have an illustration to show how love is shared. When we give it to others, when we do something good to others, we are simply showing them love. When we care for others, we simply give them love. When we give, when we share, when we do anything for others, that is love that we are sharing. I'm going to show you something that shows how love is shared and how it changes people's lives. Children, when you meet your friends, try to do good to them. Play with them. Give them something that you have. I have something here called beetroot. It is red in color. And I have a glass and a bottle of water. I'll pour water in the glass. And this water represents someone who you will help. And this beetroot represents a good action or the love that you will share. When we do something to someone, that person will never remain the same. And that person can also do the same to others, or something else that will benefit the other person. So this is beetroot I'm putting in this water, which has been plain. But when you add in this love, or any action of love, this person will never remain the same. You see how love has changed the water, and the water is red now, or maroon in color. So when you do anything good for someone, or when you give someone something, or you help someone who is sick, or you play with someone, or you pray with someone, that person will never remain the same. And when this person also gives another person, however small it will be, this water will do what? Will change, and that person will change too. Children back home, do good to your children, like Ruth did to Naomi. Naomi decided to go to the fields to work and look for some grains to bring and cook for who? For Naomi. She cooked for her. She washed for her. She cleaned around for her. She prayed with her. She used to talk with her. Children, do you talk with your parents? Please do the same like Ruth. Let us do the same. Do to our neighbors. Let us talk to our neighbors. Do you talk to your neighbor? How long have you taken without talking to your neighbor? Have you called someone to say I love you, to say I remember you, to say I pray for you? Children, let us remind our parents if they don't do. Let us do something for someone. Like this water has changed, that person will change too. Like Ruth did to Naomi, any person can do to another one. And Naomi, as Naomi also loved back to her daughter-in-law, any person you will love, you will show any action of love, that person will give back to another person. And God will bless you. That is how God's love is shared. Thank you so much. God bless you. Amen. Let's pray. Dear loving Father, we want to thank you so much because you loved us and you gave us your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him will have eternal life. Because of that love, we have to share it too. Help us to share it with everyone around us. Let our children also share it with the fellow children. Let us share it in church. Let us share it in the community. We love you, O Lord. Thank you so much for loving us. For we pray in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
our daily bread. Turning lives around, there's not another way. With salvation at His best, I'm grateful to You, God. Thank You for letting me lean on You. Thank You, God, for letting me lean on You. Lord, as a sinner I come for cleansing at Your feet. With a broken heart, Lord, I submit and say thank You for letting me lean on You. Thank You, God, for letting me lean on You. Lord, as a sinner I come for cleansing at Your feet. With a broken heart, Lord, I submit and say thank You for letting me lean on You. Trusting in Your grace, Lord, You reign forever.
In my life I'm free, Your light shine through my path.
Your circle in my life gives me urge to follow. I said thank You for letting me lean on You. Thank You, God, for letting me lean on You. Lord, as a sinner I come for cleansing at Your feet. With a broken heart, Lord, I submit and say thank You for letting me lean on You. Thank You, God, for letting me lean on You. Lord, as a sinner I come for cleansing at Your feet. With a broken heart, Lord, I submit and say thank You for letting me lean on You. And say thank You for letting me lean on You. And say thank You for letting me lean on You.
Happy Sabbath. And the Lord is good. And all the time. I want to take this opportunity to welcome you on this special Sabbath day. Those of you who are present physically, and those that are joining us from your homes and wherever you may be. We want to thank the Lord for His leading and His mercies upon us. Thus far, not only in this week past, but also in the days since we started this new year 2021. I do not think that it is too late to say Happy New Year and to congratulate you for the past year 2020. I do congratulate you because 2020 has been a year historical, a year that has gone into the annals of history as a year unprecedented in the history of our lives, a year that saw us close down as institutions of learning, a year that transformed our worship system into what we have today, a year that brought us more deaths into a single disease like no other before. It's a year that has destabilized not only the economy, but our routines of life, a year that has even affected our homes and families, a year that we will live to tell a story about. It is for that reason that today I chose to talk to you from a text, from the text of the book of Ruth, under the title, Hope in the Midst of Chaos. Hope in the Midst of Chaos. Our scripture reading, like our sister read to us, is drawn from the book of Ruth, chapter 1, verses 1 to 3, that says, Now it came to pass, in the days when the judges ruled, that there was famine in the land. And a certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, went to dwell in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons. The name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife was Naomi, and the names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion, Ephraimites of Bethlehem, Judah. And they went to the country of Moab and remained there. But Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died there. And she was left and her two sons. And the two sons also died from there. Come with me to John, the Gospel according to John, chapter 16 and verse 33, that says, The things I've spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulations, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Hope in the midst of chaos. Before we go any further, may I invite you to bow your heads with me as we seek the Lord in prayer. Eternal God, our Heavenly Father, another special moment is here for us as we sit quietly at your throne and at your feet, that we may hear from you as you speak to us from your word through the promptings of your Spirit, that we will be able to receive your divine blessings. You've chosen today a feeble one like me, that you could make me a channel of communication for your word to your people. I pray that may I subside, that you be lifted. May I disappear, that you may be seen. And may you have your way, that Lord, you will be able to minister to us today, that we will hear your word, that when we come to the end of this message, we will acknowledge that we've been to the house of the Lord, that he has spoken to us, that he has blessed us to the glory of his name. We want to thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. The book of Ruth is one of the only two books of the Bible that are named after women, the other one being the book of Esther. It's one of the smallest books of the Bible with only four chapters. However, even though this book is so small, it is a remarkable book that contains profound spiritual gems to guide and comfort the troubled soul in this world of sin. Chapter 1 of this book gives us the historical setting of this small book when it says it was written in the days when the judges ruled in Israel. You will be able to go back and realize that when the children of Israel were led by Moses and later on by Joshua into the promised land, they settled there, but God chose to lead them not by any other type of instrument of leadership, but through the leadership of the judges. And we have a number of judges that are listed there, on the last one being that being Samuel. And this, it was during the times before they had any king in Israel that this book is said to have been written. The story of this book is of a family of four people: the husband called Elimelech, the wife called Naomi, and two of their sons, Mahlon and Chilion, who set out from Bethlehem of Judah to go and find sanctuary in the neighboring country of Moab, because there was famine that has struck the land of Bethlehem. And when they go to Moab, we're told that the boys got to become of age, and they happen to get married into the land of Moab from among the Moabite ladies. And they got married to two beautiful Moabites, Orpah and Ruth, to whom this particular book is named after. While in Moab, we're told that calamity struck, that all the three men in Naomi's life, the husband Elimelech, and the two children, the two sons, Mahlon and Chilion, tragically and suddenly died, leaving the three destitute widows in a predominantly patriarchal community. After they settled there for some time, we're told that news got to Naomi that famine had subsided in her homeland, and that there was now plenty of food. She, Naomi, decided to go back home because she had gone there because of the famine. But her two daughters, Orpah and Ruth, the Bible says, stuck and clung upon her, wanting to go to Bethlehem with her. The mother-in-law spoke to them passionately, and we are told that Orpah was able to see sense in her mother's low reservations and objections, and she decided to go back home to Moab to her parents. But the Bible says Ruth clung upon Naomi, and there, by proclaiming one of the most profound vows the Bible has ever expressed. When you come to verses 16 and 17 of this book of Ruth in chapter 1, she said to Naomi, when Naomi was pleading with her to go back to her home and be able to find promise and to find blessings once again in life. But Naomi in verse 16 says, Ruth in verse 16 says, "But Ruth said, entreat me not to leave you, or to turn back from following after you, for where you go, I will go, and where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God shall be my God. Where you die, I will die, and there will I be buried. May the Lord do so to me, and more also, if anything but death parts you and me company." It is said that if there is any statement of promise, if there is any vow between two people ever expressed in the Bible to cleave them inseparably together, this stands out as one of the epitomes ever proclaimed in the Bible. The story reaches its climax with a happy ending in Bethlehem, where Naomi finds one of her close relatives, Boaz, who accepts to take Ruth as his wife, according to the cultural norms of the biblical times. That is the story of the book of Ruth. I can as well say at this moment that the sermon is done, because the story is here, and that is the entire story of the book of Ruth. However, it suffices to say that you would allow me to make a few highlights for our edification from within this plot of this story before I can send you home. Remember, we are working and looking at hope in the midst of chaos. The Bible says in verse 1 of chapter 1 that now it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled Israel that there was famine in the land, and a certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, went to dwell in the country of Moab, he and his wife and two sons. As we have seen from the plot, the flow of the story, when Elimelech goes over to dwell in that land of Moab, tragedy struck that he died from there. Not only him, but even his two sons, bringing almost a tragic end to a patriarchal family of this man, leaving only three widows behind. But one thing is striking in this verse 1, is when it says there was famine in the land of Bethlehem. Famine in the land of Bethlehem. This statement is set in what can be termed as a striking paradox. Bethlehem in Judah and in the entire Israel was known to be the food basket of the entire country. It was named Bethlehem so because of its ideal climatic conditions suitable for all types of crops, and fruits of every taste came from this land. Bethlehem. The name Bethlehem in Hebrew is a compound word which is derived from two words, Beth and Lehem, which means house of food or house of bread. And it was named so because it was the food basket for the entire country of Judah, indeed Israel. However, famine is to be found in the house of food, in the house of bread. Famine in the house of food. How is that possible? And yet the Bible tells us that yes, true, it happened. There are friend situations in this world when life seems to offer us the opposite. Famine in the land of food. Those times when life seems to offer us the reverse, the unexpected, and the contrary situation is far from our expectations. It is possible also in this world to lack and to be in need in the house of your parents where they're supposed to be providing for you. It is said to be possible to be a pauper when you're a child of nobility. It is possible to feel lonely even when you are in a crowd. It is possible to fail even to be saved when you are situated in the very house of God. It is also said to be possible that you can lose Christ even within his kingdom. It's possible to get lost even within the church circles. Friends, this world where we live in is a world which can present unfamiliar situations even when we least expect them. But the greatest mistake that Elimelech ever made was to take and decide to move his family out of Bethlehem, though there was famine there, though there was an unseeming situation there. The biggest mistake ever made by the father of the house was to take his family out of Bethlehem, out of the house of bread that had temporarily been struck by need and lack, to the country, not any other country, but to the country of Moab. Moab couldn't have been the place for Elimelech to take his family in the midst of trouble. Bible students think that he could have chosen any other country other than Moab. His greatest mistake was in his choice. Moab, first and foremost, was deemed an enemy territory. There was bad blood between Israel and Moab right from the genesis of the coming up of these two communities. And it reached climax when the children of Israel were moving from Egypt to the promised land, wanting to pass through the territory of Moab, and they rose up an enmity against their own people and refused them passage. Though related, Moab and Israel, their relationship was an unfortunate one. For Moab, history tells us that was the son of Lot, born out of his first biological daughter. You go over to Genesis and get that story clear. The name Moab was given to this man who later on became a tribe and a country, because it means from father or out of father, which later on came to symbolize a deviation from the norm. Born from the father, born out of the father. And it's a name which later on through history came to symbolize a deviance, an exodus from the ideal or from the norm. It's for that reason that Bible students think that if there was a country that Elimelech could have chosen for his refuge and sanctuary in the midst of famine and challenges of life, it couldn't have been such a country which symbolized deviancy, which symbolizes something that takes us away from the Father. By Elimelech taking his family away from Bethlehem to Moab, he was literally moving his family away from the source of blessings. He was literally moving his family away, yes, temporarily from a famine that has struck, but he was taking his family away from the house of food. He was, in so doing, taking his family away from his ancestry. He was taking his family away from its roots. He was taking his family away from where it belonged. He was taking his family away from his heavenly father to an enemy territory. No wonder the things that befell this family live to be told, because he not only lost the battle from their thinking he could have died before, but he died in a foreign land. And there he was buried, never to be brought back home. In the foreign land, he not only lost his family, his life, but he also lost his two sons that could have continued on his lineage, but were never to be seen back home. It is better to die home than to die wandering in a foreign land. But the choice was one which was unfaithful and unfortunate. Children of God, I want you to listen to what the Word of God has to say. It may appear sometimes uncomfortable for you at home. Sometimes it may appear as if where you are seems not to give you the comfort and the joy and the happiness that you envision or you crave for. It may be that you are dissatisfied with your environment, but the Bible bears testimony that east or west, home is what? Home is best. The Bible bears testimony that you can tell you on at home. It may be that you're not comfortable even with your church, but it still remains your church. It may be that you're not comfortable with the girls of your church for marriage, but they remain your own. It may be that you're not comfortable with the boys of your church and you look at them and despise them, but they remain the ones who are your own. You may not be comfortable with your roots, but they remain the roots from which God chose you to belong and to come up from. Stay home. Stuck to your roots, because that is where you belong. Going out of the church, going anywhere away from home, tantamount to suicide, and you may never ever come back home alive. But something else strikes me in this text of chapter 1, verse 1, and that is in the name Elimelech. The name Elimelech in Hebrew means "my God is king." It's another striking paradox that one whose name carries so much and lofty a message can deny the meaning of his name and run away from his divine father and king and go and seek refuge to another land over foreign gods. Eli, my God, Melech is king. This was an act of betrayal, a vote of no confidence in his God, him who knew but allowed the situation to come. He who is the one that created the rain, and he who allowed the territory of Bethlehem to be named as the house of food. He who is the creator of the universe, and he who allowed him also to be named my God is king. Elimelech as a testimony and a message to show that no matter the circumstances, God remains God. He chooses to leave the house of bread and the temporary challenges of famine and loses the battle somewhere else where he thought he could be able to get refuge and sanctuary. I don't know how many times you also might have run away from your father, from your house, from your territory when life's challenges have come upon you. We attempted always to run away from challenges, but victors are not people who retreat nor run away. Victors are people who engage. Victors are people who get involved. You can only be called a victor after an engagement and an overcoming. The life that is before us is a life that 2020 also showed us, which life 2021 may not be any different, but which tells us, even as Christ says that in this world you will have tribulations, is a world full of challenges. For as one man said, we are born Christ, and we move through the world complaining, and we die unsatisfied. That is the type of life that we are in. And it was also Job that said, man born of woman is a few days but full of trouble. That is the life that we are in this world of sin. We come in this world crying, and we live out in tears. Therefore, running away from situations sometimes may not be the answer. There are times when the Bible tells us that situations will come our way, not to destroy us. For the Bible, Paul tells us that before he allows a situation to come to us, he will have sieved, he will have weighed and understood the weight of that situation before he allows any situation that may come upon us. A consolation. That whatever you may be going through, God is aware, because he is omniscient. He knew it, and he allowed it, and he knows you, and he understands even the end, that he has allowed it for a reason and for a purpose. Take root, take your ground, face the situation, engage sometimes the battles, other than running away from them and making retreats. For many of them come to make up our character and also to build up our faith. and to give us a story and a testimony to tell when all is said and done. It is my plea that no matter life's challenges, no matter the uncertainties or suffering that you may be enduring, that you will wait on the Lord for his intervention and sometimes for his timing. I want to talk to you from another important gem from this book, and that is about Ruth and Orpah. The two Moabite ladies. When you read through this book, you get the impression that Chilion and Mahlon must have died shortly after marrying these two Moabite young ladies, because none of them is left with a child. And he said that when calamity had struck the family, and the father and the two boys had died, leaving the two young ladies behind, the mother-in-law, hearing that the land of Bethlehem had been blessed once again, as an understanding mother-in-law, Naomi pleaded with the two young ladies to go back to their respective parents and find new husbands, establish a new future, for she was sincere to them and quite empathetic in the situation that they were, for they were young ladies still with promise. The Bible records that Orpah sees sense and goes back to her people, but that was not for Ruth. These two ladies represent two worlds of people who come into our lives. Orpah represents those people who we start with in life, but we many times never go through with to the end. Orpah represents those people who will be there in our life at some point, who we'll enjoy life with, but who will at one time or the other depart from us. She represents those people who come into our lives for a reason and for a reason. And when that is done and fulfilled, they take their departure. She represents a people who may go with us through life's challenges, but are not meant to be part of our destiny. They're not meant to be part of our victory. Allow me to tell you that when such people come in your lives, however good they may be, some of them will go, and when they go, let us not whine, for they were there at that time, and their time has come that they may take exit. And then when that exit comes, we should look up and give God the glory for their life. Some of them will die. Some of them will just leave and depart. Some of them will be there, but without any influence in our lives. But they will be there, and their time will come and end. Allow them to go when the time comes, because they will have served their purposes. However, there are some people who, like Ruth, are part of our story and part of our destiny. People who come to stay no matter the circumstances. There will be situations between you and those people, situations that will shake you and want to pull you apart. But the more the shaking and the pulling will happen, the more strong the bonds and the cords that join you together will become. Ruth clung upon Naomi, and as I told you before, declared one of the most profound vows ever recorded in the Bible. Ruth, say, entreat me not to leave you. No, turn back from following after you. For wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God shall be my God. Where you die, I will die, and there will I be buried. And then she concludes with a statement of self-curse and say, the Lord do so to me and much more, if anything but death do you and me part. That statement only is enough for another 30 to 1 hour somewhere. I have not the time and the luxury to unpack it. But this is a very profound statement. A statement that is even missing among people that make their vows on the wedding day between spouses. A statement that lives to be tested in time. A young lady of promise. Mother-in-law tells her, you're still young and the children that I bore have died. And even if you love me so much and you decide to go with me, I cannot go get pregnant again because I have no man. But even if I get another man and get pregnant, how will you wait for another 18 years for that man? How old will you be? She was trying to impress upon her how impossible the situation was for her, how unfruitful it was that she would continue together with her in life. She was still young, and her parents were still alive. She had a community. Naomi was going back to Israel, and she was a foreigner. She couldn't be so much welcomed by the Israelites because she didn't belong there, but she had a family and a community to belong to. And she tells her, go back home. Go back to your parents. You have not produced any child. You're still young. You have still a future. But this woman, this young lady, looks at all those impossibilities, looks at all those stuck future elements, but decides to forsake her parents, decides to forsake her community. She decides to forsake her country. She decides to forsake her goals and be able to clung upon her mother-in-law who could not give her anything but just love. And this is said to be one of the greatest denials and sacrifices one can ever give for love. The Bible uses a word here, which word is only found in Genesis when it says that the two shall cleave together and become one. And that's the word that is being used here. But she doesn't only use that word, but she ends it with a self-cursing statement and says, may anything that your God deems happen upon me if I don't live by the dictates of my promise. My brother, my sister, God will always plant people in your way to carry you to your destiny. And this was one planted for Naomi to move on with her to her destiny. We are never alone, for he is there for us, but even then he plants people in our lives, people who will be able to hold us, people who will be able to encourage us, people who will be able to believe in us, people who will be able to support us, people who will be able to love us in spite of ourselves. Treasure those people, for they are part of your story and they are part of your destiny. The Bible presents a number of such people. Elijah had Elisha, and David had Jonathan, and Jesus had his three with him. Treasure them, for it is said that one's social capital equals their true worth in life. One's social capital equals their true worth in life. Who is your Ruth in your life? Are you a Ruth to someone? We are living in a world where people love us because of what we are and what we have and what we can give them. and we can do to them. Such love is a love that is deficient in many of us. But today we can challenge ourselves to love someone in spite of gains. To love someone not because they are positioned, not because they are blessed, but because we love them. We need such friends on our journey. And we need to be such friends in the journey of other people. I want to look at another important element here, and that is on Naomi. Naomi, the mother-in-law. The name Naomi means delight. In Hebrew, this name is rich. It means pleasant. It means beautiful. The name Naomi means lovely. It means charming and winsome. However, when you go over, by the way, before I go over, when you look at the Hebrew economy, you'll be able to appreciate and understand that they didn't name their children anyhow. Naming in Israel had a purpose, a reason, and future implications. So they named their children purposefully. They didn't pick and throw names upon children. Children were named, and those names, Bible tells us in best testament, they affected their character and also their destiny. But Naomi is given a very beautiful name, which means beautiful, which means pleasant, which means delight, lovely, charming, and winsome. However, when you go over to Ruth chapter 1, verse 21 and 20 and 21, you get to see that something struck the life of Naomi. The Bible says, but she said to them, when she was returning back to Bethlehem, do not call me Naomi, call me Mara, for the Almighty has dealt very bitterly with me. I went out full, and the Lord has brought me home again empty. Why do you call me Naomi? Since the Lord has testified against me and the Almighty has afflicted me. You know, sometimes we have a wrong theology about God. And even when we stand sometimes to preach, we understand and package God according to our own understanding. True theology tells us that God is beyond definition. The moment you ever come to a level of wanting to cocoon, to package and define God and think you have him, theology tells us that you have missed the mark. For God is beyond description. Theology tells us that the moment you attempt to define God is the moment you lose him. For God reveals only facets about himself and not fully himself. Ellen White will be able to tell us that even when we shall get to eternity, we shall mingle and interact with God, but from eternity to eternity, we will never exhaust who he and what he is. That is the God we serve. But many times we cocoon him and think this and think that. Even Naomi did the same. And when those circumstances come in life, sometimes the world will inflict us, as it did to Naomi. It will inflict and afflict us that we even attempt to change our identity and self-worth. Naomi moves from the beautiful, from the pleasant, from the charming, the winsome, and the delight one, and chooses another identity because of what she's gone through. She baptizes herself a new name called Mara, which means bitterness. because of what the world thrown in her face. You know, sometimes, as I've said, the world may challenge us to a point of losing our identity and even our self-worth. However, like Naomi, I don't know what you may be going through, the suffering and pain and betrayal that you may be in, the abandonment, the disappointment, the heartache, the suffering and the loss that you may have endured, and all sorts of afflictions and inflictions in life. You may be going through a time that is rough, and you might have been there for some time. These challenges make us cry. They make you regret and lose hope and want to give up. And sometimes you ask, why, God? And there, you tend to lose your self-worth and your self-respect and even your identity. But the story of Naomi is a testimony that as long as life endures and we are still living, there is still hope. However chaotic life may be, as long as we are still alive, it's an indication and a testimony that God still has a future and something to do for us. And what he's about to do is better than what we have been today. And the tomorrow is better than our today. The story of Naomi tells us that our worth and identity are not to be defined by life circumstances, by the things that life brings into our face, but our identity and our self-worth should be measured and decreed by him who created us, him who governs our movement, him who has our future in his hand. And that is our goal. It is not over with me until it is over by God for me. And as long as I'm alive, I may fall, but God can raise me up even higher. It is possible that I may suffer loss, but like he did and allowed it to happen upon Job, he might raise me up even sevenfold higher. It may even happen that he can allow me to suffer and even be buried, but he can raise me up like he did to Lazarus. For we serve such a God who is a God of impossibilities, a God whose word is final and not what people say about us, not what life presents before us. Because as I've told you, many of the things allowed in our lives in God that God may be able to build our character and steal and polish our faith in him, so that we can tell a story about his goodness and about his mercies upon us. Friends, time cannot allow me to go into all the things that this book presents, but allow me only to say one more before I can send you home. And that can't be left out, for it is the gist of this book. And that is about Ruth and Boaz. When Naomi and Ruth reach Bethlehem, they find a warm reception indeed. According to the custom, Naomi identifies a responsible and prosperous young man by the name of Boaz, who was a close relative of her husband. And this one they identify to be a suitable partner in marriage for Ruth. And he becomes a kinsman redeemer, a goel of kind of sorts. Much is there that God knows our destiny. Even when we feel as if the road has ended, God intervenes as a redeemer to rescue us from those situations that seems to be dead ends. And he did so with Naomi, and he did so even with Ruth. This is a testament to tell us that God is no respecter of persons and he discriminates no one, for even a Moabite girl can come in Israel and find belonging. That when we forsake other things for God, as Ruth did, and stand for God when she says, your God will be my God and your people will be my people, God stands up and he becomes our God. And when those situations come, we can only know that God has the last word, and that last word is always beautiful when he utters it finally. And that's the story of Ruth. That's the story of Naomi. That we can be foreigners, but we can find belonging even in a foreign land. Because our Father is the creator of us all, and he is all sovereign above all. One thing that I want to leave you with in this 2021 is brought from the action that this lady does, that Mrs. Makar talked about. And that's the act of Naomi going over to the garden and starting to pick certain grains there for their survival. They knew that the end had come for them, and they survived only on a daily basis. And that practice of going to pick grains in someone's garden is enshrined in the Torah as the law of gleaning. The law of gleaning, or the practice of gleaning. And the practice of gleaning is well espoused in 2:7, when the Bible says, and she said, please let me glean and gather after the reapers among the sheaves. So she came, and the report goes on, continued from morning till now, though she rested a little in the house. This is the law of gleaning. In the Torah, God had instructed that the landless poor of Israel, those who were the slaves, the foreigners, the orphans and the widows, and the Levites who happened to be landless, God decreed that these were supposed to be taken care of by the land people and the wealthy members of the community. It so happened that when the rich planted their fields and harvest time came, the law dictated that they were not supposed to go and harvest the corners of their fields. And those corners were left for the poor community that I've named of Israel. The poor community of Israel would go in those corners of the fields and freely partake of any grain, any produce that they found there. But furthermore, it is also stated in the Torah that you were not only supposed to leave the corners of the fields, but you were supposed to harvest with an eye and a mentality to leaving behind everything, for you were not supposed to comb thoroughly your field while harvesting. You were supposed to leave behind, even in the middle of the field, some produce for the poor to come and pick. And when a poor person came in the field, you didn't think that they were trespassing. They were not loitering. That was their belonging, because God had decreed it upon them. And it's from within this tradition that Naomi sends Ruth to go into the field that she could find, because it was harvest time. And God had rained his blessings upon Bethlehem once again. So she sends her, go into the field. And wherever you find, glean. And she went. But though it was her right, the Bible records in the text that she sought permission from the reapers. She said, can I go behind you, that I may be able to get advantage of what you have left behind? And that is the character of this young lady. You know, many times we trumpet our rights. not knowing that there are certain things that surpass our rights. Common sense and good behavior. She goes over to greet them. She goes over to strike a common understanding with them that when the owner of the farm comes around, the reapers are able to give a good report about this lady, a foreigner they knew. You know, many times, young ladies, I wish we were in a marriage seminar. This book speaks volumes also. We many times have lost out because we have claimed our rights much more than instill our character and behaviors before the community. She was a lady of class. And so, I want you to notice that this law stipulated that the poor had to go and fend for themselves. God was not instituting a law of gifts and aid. The children of Israel had to go literally by themselves and make provisions for themselves. And although God is putting up this law and provision for these less advantaged people, God did not encourage laziness in Israel. The poor had to go out and fend for themselves. In the year 2021, God has still made provisions for our welfare and survival. But God expects you and I to go out and fend for our blessing. God is not going to expect us to just make a vision and to pray and also see dreams and be able to pray and wait on God. God expects us that when we have seen the vision, when we have dreamed, and when we have prayed, we don't sit there but move out and reach for those blessings that God has put in the world. And the year 2021 is not going to be any year different. It's just another calendar year. It's the same year as the years previous, for it will also have 12 months. It will also have 4 weeks in every month. It will also have 7 days in every week, 24 hours in every day, and 60 minutes in every hour. You can continue on. Friends, this year also, the sun will rise like it rose and set like it set in the previous years. Rain will come and sunshine will be seen. There will be day and night, for it's just another calendar year. There will be tears. There will be sorrows. Even as there will be joys and laughter. What God expects you and I for this year is that, yes, there are challenges because we live in a challenging world, a chaotic world, because even what we have seen in 2020 has also borne testimony. What we have seen at the beginning of this year has also borne testimony. The corona is still with us, and the economy is still suffering. Politics is going wayward. We do not expect so much glory and happiness, especially in the times we live in, for we are drawing closer to the times of the end. But come though it may, the Bible tells us that we can be able, like Christ told us, that in this world you will have tribulations, but be of good cheer, because I've done what? I have overcome. Your solace and your confidence and my confidence and solace in the fact that when we go out in this world of sin, we are not alone, but He is with us. Our solace and confidence are that when we go out, God knows the challenges we are going through, because He's been here and He has seen and gone through it. And He knows when we pray and call upon Him for help. He's waiting upon you to ask Him to go out with you. Though we cannot change the calendar and the seasons of the year, though there are many things we cannot change, But there are certain things you and I can be able to change in this world of life. For we, like Naomi and Ruth, we can change our direction and our location. We are not created to be static and there forever. We can move from where we are into the arms of God. This year, we can be able to also determine and change our attitude and mindset. We can be able to change our work ethic, but most importantly, we can be able to change our associations and the friends and the companies that we keep. And that's what Naomi did. The moment she realized the predicament she was in Moab, she knew where she belonged. She knew where God was. And she decided to go. But one thing is beautiful here, that there is one other woman who saw what Naomi saw, and that was Ruth. You can see also what Ruth saw. By going to the God of Naomi, by going to the people of Naomi, by going to the place where God is found, and that's in the bosom of God. This time, this year you can be able to change your proximity with God. How close are you with the fountain of blessing? It is my prayer that as you go through 2021, you will be able to learn lessons from the story of Ruth and Naomi. That these stories will be able to impact you to know that our circumstances may be challenging, but our future and destiny are sure in the Lord our God. And he is ready to go with us the moment we ask him to go with us. God is just a call away, for the Bible says, ask. And he is waiting for us to ask, to seek him, and to call him to be partners with us. Because the world ahead of us, and the challenges that bedevil us and wait upon us are immense, that you alone cannot be able to make it. You may have wandered far, but today God calls you back to Bethlehem. God calls you back into his house. God calls you back into his fold, saying you are not safe where you are, for challenges may happen in the church. Challenges may happen at home, but still it remains home and remains the church of God. Come home, because God is there waiting for you. It's not safe for you to be there alone, for he calls you, saying, yes, those challenges, I know, they're meant for your good, because we will fight and go through them together unto victory. Is my prayer for you. In Jesus' name. Amen. May I request you to rise up with me as we sing the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, it's been another moment before your throne of grace. Thank you that you have challenged us once again from your word, especially from the story of Ruth and Naomi. Help us that we will live to learn our lessons. Help us, Lord, that we will make our future secure in you. That though challenged and bedeviled by the challenges of this world, we can rest assured that we'll be shaken, but not annihilated. We'll be chastised, but not destroyed. I pray for these, your sons and daughters, those present and those listening and watching from various places, that, Lord, may 2021 be a year of struggle, but a struggle with you unto victory. That in the end, Lord, we'll look back and see the hills and valleys, the thick and thin that you've taken us through, and give praise not to ourselves, but to you alone, who is our defender, you who is our warrior and our guide. Thank you for today. May your blessings continue to be upon us for now and even forevermore. It is our prayer and thanksgiving in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you and thank you.
say amen to that wonderful presentation. And we rise once again with our hymnal song number 508, Anywhere with Jesus, I Can Safely Go.
Anywhere with Jesus I can safely go. Anywhere he leads me in this world below. Anywhere without him dearest joys would fade. Anywhere with Jesus I am not afraid. Anywhere, anywhere, fear I cannot know. Anywhere with Jesus I can safely. Anywhere with Jesus I am not alone. Other friends may fail me, he is still my own. Though his hand may lead me over dreary ways, anywhere with Jesus is a house of praise. Anywhere, anywhere, fear I cannot know. Anywhere with Jesus I can safely. Anywhere with Jesus I can go to sleep. When the darkness shadows round about me creep, knowing I shall wake and never more to roam. Anywhere with Jesus will be home, sweet home. Anywhere, anywhere, fear I cannot know. Anywhere with Jesus I can still.
And now, may the grace of our loving God and the love of God and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forever, in Jesus' name,
amen.
God bless you.